Hey, as we await the arrival of Ohio State in the interview room, we have the outstanding players. The J. Curtis Sanford Outstanding Offensive Player is number 12, Brady Cook, the quarterback from Missouri. And the Felix R. McKnight Outstanding Defensive Player is number 15, Johnny Walker Jr., the defensive lineman from Missouri. So Brady Cook, the quarterback from Mizzou, and Johnny Walker Jr., defensive lineman from Mizzou, are the outstanding players of the game. Okay, you got water.
Are you going to have players in the breakout room here over there at the same time as these guys?
Yeah, but that you'll have time to get them, hopefully. Question about the Ohio State student athletes. They will be in green room B and C across the hall. And Missouri student athletes will be in green room A across the hall. Bigger room for Missouri, the two smaller breakout rooms for Ohio State. Hey, man, here comes the judge. How you doing? What? Okay, we are now joined by the Ohio State student athletes and Coach Ryan Day. No streaming, no video. We don't have them yet. Just a quick note, here in the interview room, no streaming, no video. We're all depending upon Hammond Communications, okay? Remember, all breakout sessions take place across the hall. Okay, we are now joined by Coach Ryan Day, the head coach of the Ohio State University. Coach, we'll come to you first for an opening statement on tonight's game.
Yeah, we'll go right to questions. Thanks.
Okay. First question, where's our microphone, people? Okay, mic's coming. We're going to come to you right here as soon as we get the mic, and it's on its way. Okay, front row here on the right, Coach.
Hi, Ryan. I'm sure you came into this game looking for optimism and clarity, particularly at the quarterback position. Where do you go after this game? Obviously, Devin only played, you know, not even a whole half.
Right.
But didn't look great. Obviously, Lincoln, first time out there in a significant action. Where do you kind of go at quarterback right now?
Well, I feel like Lincoln got put in a tough spot there, to say the least. And you know, I thought he battled his tail off, but clearly, you know, we didn't help him up front. You know, didn't run the ball well enough, and freshman quarterback out there, for the first time playing, and we're not running the ball well enough up front. So, it's hard to get much of an evaluation coming out of the game when you can't get any balance, and I felt like we could have helped him in certain areas, we didn't.
Okay, our student athletes, let's introduce them, Lincoln Keenholtz and Jack Sawyer. Other questions? I think we have one here on the front row.
Yeah, Ryan, straight to the point there about the offensive line play tonight. Just what's your take immediately? And number two, Carson Hinsman didn't play center. Obviously, y'all made the switch, Matt Jones, Inagvimahi, right guard. But their speed rushers just kind of had a night tonight. What's your take on it?
Well, I felt more in the. Certainly there was some zero pressure that came, and they, they were aggressive on Link, but in the run game, I just felt like there were a couple things that hit, but overall, when you have a young kid in there, you got to be able to run the football and take some pressure off, and we didn't do that well enough in order to win the game. The defense played plenty good enough. I thought they played their tails off and ran out of gas a little bit down the stretch, but You know, to give up 14 points and what is it, 331 yards? Is that what it was? Yeah, I mean, they played great and you know, good enough to win. The defense did. You know, we just could have put it together on offense, and so you know, I mean, that's the story of the game.
And just from your vantage point, sending Lincoln in for his first real series on the 5-yard line. Yeah. In the ballgame, just what's going through your mind there, and what were you just cautioning him about as he goes in there?
Well, I mean, when you're a freshman quarterback who comes in during the summer, you know, you don't have the spring. You know, you really don't have much of a preseason, and then you get thrown, you know, into it with, you know, with the scouts a little bit here and there. But you know, when Kyle was in there and Devin was getting reps with the twos, Lincoln really didn't get many reps. So he did get some reps in bowl practice, but that's not like playing in a game. And you know, I think his first few drives were inside the 10-yard line. That's a tough place to be. And what I didn't want to do was put him in a situation where he's going to turn the ball over and maybe see something that he's not used to seeing. And then all of a sudden, now we're really battling uphill. What I felt like we could do there is get into halftime, get it settled, you know, and then try to get the ball towards midfield, which we did. Defense got us a stop, got us at midfield. We stalled and then missed the field goal. I felt like that was our chance to maybe, you know, jump on top a little bit, and then, you know, just couldn't quite get it going. But I mean, I give Lincoln credit. I mean, he got put in a tough spot and he battled out there and did make some good throws. But you know, that was a tough ask right there, and we need to help more. You know,
what was your message to the team afterwards? I mean, obviously you didn't want this kind of finish to a season and
no.
Stuff. Two straight losses, but 14-3 in a bowl game. Just no. What's your message?
Well, I just told them that I thought a lot of guys played really hard in this game, and nobody wanted to lose this game. I mean, you saw guys fighting here and there. We got tough, put in a tough spot, and we didn't respond well enough, and you know, we didn't help the young kid at all, and that's why we lost the game. So it hurts to, you know, finish the season like this, you know, with two losses, and that's not good enough at Ohio State, and we all know that.
Okay, let's go to the extreme left on coach's left by the curtain.
Yep. Ryan, you talked about wanting to finish on the high note and the springboard for next year, but now that's obviously not the situation. When you look at what happened tonight and what happened at the end of November, where does this need to go? What are you already thinking about to get into 2024 and turn it back around?
Well, I mean, now it's, you know, this game was very different than the last game. It was a different situation altogether. And yeah, I mean, we wanted to finish this game and build some momentum in the next year. It didn't happen. But yeah, you know, the first thing I mentioned in the room was, you know, the guys who are deciding whether they come back or not. Now they got to rally together, and you know, we got to put this team together moving forward. Of, you know, guys who are coming back and you know, get finished some unfinished business that's happened here. And I know there's some guys who feel that way.
Okay, reminder: let's have some questions at some point for either Lincoln and Jack. Next question here on the front row on the coach's right.
Yeah, Ryan, what is the status of Devin? I mean, he left. Can you give us just a general idea?
Yeah, he had a high ankle sprain and wasn't able to return.
Like you said, it's circumstantial here with the circumstances with the quarterback. Does this change anything looking at transfer portal, or does it just sort of you've got to now reassess a little bit?
Yeah, you know, I'm just fresh off the game, you know, so it's hard for me to process all of it right now, but – you know, we got to figure out what's the best for the team moving forward, and that's in a lot of areas. So we've got to take a hard look at that and get that figured out. But everything will be looked at.
Okay, extreme left now in the second row.
Coach, I wanted to just ask about some of the miscues on special teams, some of the maybe self-inflicted wounds. Are there common threads that you see with some of the mistakes, perhaps with fair catches inside the 10-yard line, false starts on punts, things to that nature?
Well, I thought overall early on the whole punting operation, other than, you know, the delay of game, but there was a funky look there, and we always tell them, hey, if you're not sure, don't snap the ball, and we ended up getting that one off. So, you know, that one there, you know, was okay, but I felt like, you know, we were punting with good hang time and we were covering and we were flipping the field at times pretty well. So I thought that was well done. But you're right. I mean, you know, we shouldn't catch the ball on the 4-yard line. Our heels should be in the 8. I think he felt like in that moment they were kind of right behind him and they were gonna pin it inside the 4. But still, you have to stick to your rules in that situation. And then we missed the field goal, and that one was big at the time. You know, it was a little momentum swing. and they get the ball back on the 30-yard line. So you know, there was some good things there, but not good enough.
Okay, on the right, outer aisle.
Ryan, when Devin was playing in that first quarter, there's still struggles. Is that a matter of new quarterback, new center, new right guard, no Marv, or is there more to it?
You know, I felt like he was going to have nerves early on. I thought we were going to be able to play through it and figure out what that looked like going into the second half. He had a little bit of nerves, but you could see him, you see the athleticism, you see him break the pocket almost, you know, just missed the throw down the sideline. He missed the screen early on, but I felt like, you know, he was going to kind of have to play through that a little bit. And this is his first start. So, and then we lose him. And, you know, we had a lot of things in the game plan designed for his style of play. And we lost him. That was, you know, it was a little bit of a scramble. And, you know, we came up short.
For Lincoln, did the game get a chance to slow down for you throughout, or was there too much pressure at that time?
I mean, it wasn't really that fast, honestly, because I go against the best defense every day in practice. So, I mean, it was pretty good. I think the Mizzou coaches were trying to speed me up, give me some zero looks. But, I mean, just other than that, I'm pretty sure, like, it was just like another game. And, I mean, I think, like, the big thing for me was that, I mean, I just got to just slow down and just focus on my mechanics and everything. And just trust my eyes.
Reminder, no video, no streaming, okay, here in the interview room. Here in the middle, on the right.
Ryan, obviously this was a different type of year at quarterback. You have Kyle the whole year. He transfers. You kind of get thrown in. You're playing Devin, and then Lincoln comes in. How would you assess the quarterback room or the quarterback play this year? I know it's fresh off the game, but just how would you assess how that went and how it impacted season?
I think it's hard to say because, you know, we're talking about, a year's worth of play of Kyle. He's not here. I don't think it's fair to me to go back and you know, go through all of that right now. And then this game was very unique. So, you know, bottom line is, you know, we didn't reach our goals this year. And that's everybody. And so, you know, the quarterback room is one of them. And so that's the bottom line. We look at a hole. We didn't get our job done. So if that's what you're looking for an answer, that's kind of what it is. But it's just, you know, I'm not going to go through and kind of evaluate Kyle at this point. I don't think that's fair. And then, you know, as you saw what happened in this game. And again, you know, we got to be able to help him out more. Some of those zero looks that Lincoln's talking about, we can do a better job with as coaches.
Left side now.
For Jack. Obviously, you tie Ohio State's sack record in a bowl game. How much more difficult now does it make it to potentially, you know, put your name in the top of the draft or come back?
Honestly, I'm not even really thinking about that right now. I'm just upset about the game. I want to send the seniors out the right way. And when you put so much work into it, you know, it's tough when, you know, you don't get the outcome you want. And I just want to give Lincoln a shout out for just stepping in there and playing with confidence in a tough spot. I thought you fought your ass off, man, and it's not easy. And you went in there and you did the best you could, man. So shout out to you, man.
In the middle here on the aisle.
Hey, Ryan, I know that you guys said that, you know, when all the dust settles from the game, you'll go make all the evaluations and stuff.
Yeah.
But we thought coming into this, and I think maybe you did too, that tonight was going to be a big piece of that evaluation pod. How do you move forward without that evaluation? Because as you said, it's been an odd game, and you obviously didn't have Devin. And the second part to that question, too, is I watched Devin after the injury and the way that he held or carried himself and on the sideline cheering. Can you just speak to the way that he handled himself after his second injury in a crucial moment during a battle?
Yeah, I mean, for Devin, I know he wanted to play in this game worse than anybody, and even after he hurt himself, you know, he wanted to get back in there and actually did it for a series, but he just, it wasn't fair to him. He couldn't move, and he wasn't supposed to be in the game at that point, but he was fighting to get back in there, and he kept a great attitude the whole time. He's a great young man with a great attitude. He's a great teammate. I don't have a great answer for that right now because this is not what we were expecting coming out of the game. You know, we didn't have a game to look at and go through and evaluate. We know what we see in practice, but, you know, it's certainly different when you play in a game. So disappointed we don't have that. So we'll get back to work and figure that part of it out. But You know, again, I don't have a great answer in that right now because we didn't have a game from Devin.
Closing questions now for Coach and his student athletes. Let's go on the left side. One note before you ask, Missouri student athletes are about to appear in Green Room A across the hall. If you have an interest in Missouri players, they will be coming shortly. Okay, question here on the left.
Ryan, why did you make the switch on the offensive line to start Matt at center and play Enoch at right guard?
You know, I don't want to get too much into it, but you know, Carson, you know, was having a tough time the last couple of weeks in practice, and we just felt like at the right time, all right, this was the right thing to do at the time. You know, was having, you know, a few issues there, and so it's not that, you know, Carson will never play here again, and you know, but based on the last couple of weeks of play, the decision was made that Matt gave us the best chance at center.
Was Chris available?
Yes, he was. Yep. Well, we felt like, you know, Lincoln had been taking all the backup reps and, you know, moving forward in the future, felt like this was the best thing. And Lincoln also gave us a chance a little bit with some of the zone read stuff, where that's not really Tristan's game. And the game plan had more of that stuff in it, even more than you saw, because it was more of that's what Devin can do. And we felt like Lincoln could at least, you know, do those type of things as opposed to Tristan. That's not really his style of game, so we felt like the right thing to do was to have Lincoln in there.
Front row on the left.
Coach, your roster was affected dramatically by guys leaving, opting out, whatever. I need you to look in the crystal ball. Do you anticipate in the next couple of years we'll see things put in place to try to ensure that rosters in the regular season look similar for the postseason, even if they're not playing in games that are affiliated with the playoff bracket?
Yeah, I hope so. I hope there's something, because you know, this, you know, you have key pieces missing, and it's just not the same team that you played with a month ago. But not that that's an excuse, it's just the way it is. And, you know, we got to go win the game. But yeah, I feel like absolutely, you know, that, and I think maybe with the playoff, that'll change things as well.
Okay, we have two questions to go. We'll take one here in the back, and then we will come up to the front.
Ryan, when you look at your offensive staff and the way that you guys were constructed this year, I know that the offense, I would assume with you thinking this, didn't get the output that you guys wanted this year.
Yeah.
How do you evaluate your offensive staff moving forward? And do you think that there's reason to look at it and potentially make changes?
Yeah, we're going to look at everything. Yeah. You know, ultimately, like you said, you know, game. I mean, this is an example of a game. Like, it doesn't. Nobody cares that you have a freshman quarterback in there. You know, you got to go win the game, and it didn't happen. So, like I said before, everything's going to get looked at, and you know, if it's what helps Ohio State go reach our goals and win these games, then we'll make those changes. So, got to really evaluate it the right way and make sure I'm doing it the right way, and do what's appropriate, what's best for the program.
Hey, no, we're going to have to come up front. This will be the last question right now. Microphones up here, okay? Yeah. Front row.
One for Jack and for Lincoln. Jack, is it kind of true that you just kind of wore down as the game went on? And that, how will this affect not just your decision, you think, but the other people in your situation in terms of coming back? And for Lincoln, how much do you think this experience, as tough as it was, will help you down the road, if that's the way you feel?
Lincoln, why don't you start with that?
I'd say I think it was an awesome experience. I mean, just going out there, just playing in the Cotton Bowl was crazy fun. I mean, I think being out there was hard at first, but I think just the experience of playing a lot, and I mean, just being out there throwing, running a little bit, I mean, it just helps me build like my, like my platform for the next 4 or 5 years. So, yeah.
Okay, Jack?
You know, I think a lot of us all are on the same page about, you know, we don't want to end our Ohio State careers like this, with two tough losses. You know, we all love it here. We love Coach Day. We love the staff. And, you know, sometimes, you know, unfortunate things happen and you don't get the outcome you want. And I think that's going to play a big decision and her big factor in our decisions.
Okay, guys, thank you so much for coming. terrific season, and we enjoyed having you with us this year for the 88th Classic. Breakouts across the hall for Ohio State in Green Room B and C. Green Room A. Green Room A will be the Missouri student athletes, and I believe they might be over there at the moment. Hey, you're welcome, man. Good to see you. Just to let you know, Brady Cook and Johnny Walker Jr. will be our student athletes here for Mizzou. Are they out there yet? Hmm? Ellie, are they out there yet? Missouri? How you doing? How you doing? Again, a reminder in this room, please no shooting video and no live streaming. Only video cameras should be Hammond Communications. And you can download that from our CFP portal. Same location, same credentials you've had all week long. Kara. Reminder, we have Missouri student athletes across the hall right now. And they are in green room A, the bigger room that we used earlier in the week for breakouts. So they are in there now, and we are waiting Coach and Brady and Johnny here in just a bit. Okay, I think we are joined by Coach, and he will be up on the stage in just a second. Congratulations. You guys got some fancy hardware. Yeah, way to go. Is Brady on his way?
Last time I saw him, he was doing snow angels.
Okay. We will catch up on him. Yeah. Okay, we are now joined by Missouri head coach Eli Drinkwitz and his one student athlete at the moment, the Felix R. McKnight Defensive Outstanding Player of the
There's
Game.
There's Brady.
Johnny Walker, Jr. Yeah. And now approaching the stage is the J. Curtis Sanford Outstanding Offensive Player, Brady Cook. Welcome, Brady. Okay, I think we're settled. And Coach, we're going to come to you first to ask for an opening statement. Tell us all about it.
Yeah, first I just want to tip my hat to Ohio State and Ryan Day you know, what a great team he has, so competitive, outstanding defense. You know, they faced a lot of adversity in that game with their quarterback going out. Tip my hat to them. But the story of the game is, you know, how hard our defense played, refused to give in, refused to blame or place blame, stick together, and then our offense just kept chopping wood. You know, we talk about developing an elite edge, and the G in edge stands for grit, a stubborn refusal to quit. And that's what our team displayed tonight, to score 14 in the fourth quarter when you're down 3-0. Just really, really proud of those guys. You know, last night our chaplain gave a message about the difference between a blue blood brotherhood and a wilderness brotherhood. In a wilderness brotherhood forged through adversity and fight and scratching and clawing for everything you get. And it just totally encompassed everything that we're about. I mean, you know, when you look at our team, we're a bunch of wilderness brotherhood guys who stick together, fight together, found a way to love each other and had each other's back. And I knew it at any point, at the locker room, these guys will tell you, I was telling them, we're right where we want to be. Let's just go win the game. And they believed us. I thought Kirby and Blake did an outstanding job just calling defense and offense and just really proud of them. So with that, I'll quit rambling.
Okay, Coach, thank you very much. Let's go to questions for Coach Brady and Johnny. First question, guys, will be on your left on the aisle.
All right. Hey, Coach. Patrick Clemens with Buckeye Wired. I've been following your career as I'm an NC State alum, and you were the OC for many of our great years. But I just wanted you to see if you could just share more insights on what this career or this big milestone win means for you personally.
Yeah.
And then also for your program, just headed into the season.
Yeah, you know, I'll be honest, it really doesn't have much to do with me. It's really about our players and our team and the legacy of the 2023 Brotherhood. And, you know, there's no me if it's not for them, if it's not for our coaching staff, if it's not for our coordinators, for our GAs, our administration. You know, so for me, it's really just about the legacy that this team leaves. You know, we have a sign in our locker room that goes around that says, when the weakest choose to run, we stand shoulder to shoulder and move forward together. And that's what our brotherhood did. And you look at these two young men to my left, they came in the very first year in COVID. And, I mean, people have transferred, people have left. We've had tough years, and they just stuck with it. They went shoulder to shoulder and moved forward together. And I can't think of anything more fitting than for these two guys to win the MVPs of the Cotton Bowl as a signal of a wilderness brotherhood. So it's really not ever going to be about me. It's going to be about our team and our coaching staff and our university.
Okay, here on the front row.
Eli, Kyle Helms with ABC 17. Being around football for such a long time, just where does this moment rank for you, and then also that fourth quarter in the way that your guys performed?
Yeah, that fourth quarter is probably going to go down, and it's going to be a tough one to beat. You know, down 3-0 to score 14, to play as well as we did. Yeah, I'm just going to be really proud. It's hard to contextualize all that stuff right now, but to win the 88th Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic in that kind of game with these men in this brotherhood, to cement ourselves as a top 10 team in the country, from going from unranked to top 10 in the country, going to be pretty special. But why stop now? Oh, yeah.
Stream left.
Coach, Chris Farblin, KCOU 81 FM. Your offense in the fourth quarter, or in the second half, had two touchdown drives of over 90 yards. I just want to ask about your offense coordinator, Kirby Moore, and really how he has impacted this team in his first year and helping to get this program where it is now.
Yeah, I mean, I think Kirby came in and did exactly what we needed him to do. Fresh set of eyes, does an outstanding job with Brady, getting him dialed in, is always trying to present new ideas to us. You know, but really when it came down to it in the fourth quarter, I thought he did an excellent job of calling what he knew our guys could execute. You know, we had that play dialed up for Marquise all week. We've actually run it several times. And it was the perfect look, the perfect call at the right time, and Brady executed it. And then that play action pass to Luther for the touchdown, you know, another great design. So, you know, Kirby is I can't say just Kirby. Kirby and Blake have been just an incredible leaders on each side of the ball. And I think it's goes back to low ego, high output, and they carry the mission or the message of the head coach to each side of the ball, and there's no ego involved. Like at halftime, Blake was ripping the defense about why we don't have a takeaway yet. I mean, I'm like, okay, bud, y'all are playing pretty good. Like, just hold on. But he just they're both just tremendous leaders.
Don't forget, we have our two student
athletes
and most
valuable
players of the game up on stage here on the right side, guys.
Sam McDowell with the Kansas City Star. Brady, I wanted to ask you, obviously the first three quarters don't go the way you wanted it to. What kind of weight is that when you go on the field and the three quarters haven't gone the way you wanted it to, and how did you push through it?
Yeah, I mean, as he said, we showed grit. The offense showed grit. We just kept chopping. We looked up, it's fourth quarter, and we have 0 points, but what are you going to do? We were driving, we were confident, we still believed in the game plan, still believed in the calls that were being sent in, and we believed in each other. So when we put up 14 in the fourth, it's no surprise to us.
And then Eli, you mentioned that these guys have been here since the beginning, and you've talked all week about just some individual adversity stories with Brady, with Cody, guys like that. What kind of lasting impact do you hope that can have on the program?
Yeah, I think it just goes back to the stick-to-itiveness, the toughness, the brotherhood that these men have forged. And this is what it's going to be. When you come to the University of Missouri, you're going to be in a wilderness brotherhood. You're going to have you're going to develop a lead edge that's energy, details, grit, emotional consistency. We're going to demand that you compete every single day to be the very best that you can be. And these guys, both coming back, can tell you what the results are going to be, not only for them personally. These guys are ultra talented, but they weren't recruited by very many people, all right? I mean, my man's got a GED, all right? Johnny Walker, you know, we flipped him late from Washington State, and he didn't play a whole lot. Last year before the bowl game, came in and talked to me about, Coach, should I transfer? Do you believe in me? What'd I tell you, Johnny?
Yes, sir.
I told him, I believe in you, man. Come back, earn it. And all he's done is developed into the most valuable player, the 88th Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic.
They will stay on the right.
Coach, Benjamin Hockman, St. Louis Post-Dispatch. I think you mentioned on the field, too, can you talk about the idea of you can't necessarily win a game in the first, second quarter, but you can win a game in the fourth quarter?
Yeah, what an awesome thing we saw Coach Carroll say the other day, and actually talked to the team about it. You can't win it in the first, can't win it in the second, can't win it in the third, but you can sure win it in the fourth quarter. And this team – they did that. They displayed that. And appreciative to Coach Carroll for demonstrating that. And then Drew Locke giving us the inspiration to go out there. And we didn't have to quite do it on the last drive of the game, but it was sure a lot of fun.
For Brady, can you just describe, I guess, the trajectory of this Mizzou football program and the idea of a lot of people coming back next year and the excitement there?
Yeah, you know, I think I said this last week. You know, this game was big for the 2023 Tigers to cap off an incredible season for the people who chose to come back for their last year and chose to come back instead of going to the NFL. You know, it's special for them and that group, but it's also special for our team next year. The guys who are coming back for one more, the coaches, you know, the brotherhood. So this is just going to give us more momentum. It's going to send us off on a little two-week break with some good energy. We'll be back ready to work in a couple weeks.
Can I just add that I'm so proud of Darius Robinson, who battled a growing injury on Wednesday, didn't come out, played every snap. KD went in the tent with a separated shoulder. I said, hey, man, you're done. He said, the hell I am. Put his stuff on, ran back out there and played unbelievably tough. JC bloodied his nose, could have easily sat out the rest of the game. Those guys have NFL futures and said, nope, we're playing for each other and we're not giving into that mindset. And that's a legacy that's going to be passed on. And I just can't tell you how incredibly proud I am of those guys and what Javon Foster, Avery Delgado, Cody Schrader, those guys put on the line for our football team tonight.
Okay, here on the front row and coaches left.
Johnny, Caden Lunsford with Indian Press and PNG High School. An absolutely masterclass on the defensive side of the ball against one of the best teams in the nation in Ohio State. How does it feel to hold a team like them down to 3 points all game long?
Well, I got to give credit to my teammates. I mean, we all just did our job, stayed in our gaps, and shut them down.
And Brady, I mean, an underdog story from finishing last year 6-7 overall to coming in this year and just being a dog all season long. And then even coming into the game after a great season, having a 31% chance by ESPN to win the game. I mean, how does it feel to beat a team like Ohio State being the underdog?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it feels like we've already been at the bottom, to be honest with you. You know, we've had some tough years, some tough games, some tough experiences together. So an opportunity like this comes up, there's nothing but excitement, let me tell you. We've been at the bottom, and we were going to fight all four quarters for this one.
Yeah, we don't really care what ESPN says or what the procrastinators say. Yeah. I mean, it's what mirror you choose to look in. You know, you can look across the field and see those guys, and, man, that wide receiver room they had looks unbelievable. And you can be intimidated by that, or you can figure out, you can look in the mirror and say, what made me? And what made us is an elite edge that we work hard every single day to develop. And it's about what's inside of us, not what's what we're facing on the outside of us. It's just about us. And that's what this team's all about. I mean, we didn't care what we didn't care about the flip-flopping of lines or who was playing, who wasn't playing. Like, all that crap didn't matter. The only thing that mattered to us was who was playing for our team. And we saw those guys in warm-ups and said, don't worry about what they look like. It's what we have inside of us. It's what we're going to display tonight.
Okay, now on the right outside aisle.
Callum McAndrew, Columbia Daily Tribune. Brady, how fitting of a way was this to send off Cody Schrader?
Oh, man. I couldn't have drawn it up any perfect, more perfect. You know, he deserves it. He embodies what our team is and what our values are and how we operate. And, man, I mean, he's just he did it. He did it. He deserves this. He deserves the credit. I mean, I can't say enough about him. I mean, I'm just so proud of that guy. And, you know, I hope he's got a smile on his face right now.
And Eli, the touchdown run from Cody, how much is that embodying the wilderness brotherhood that you were talking about a little bit earlier?
Yeah, you know, on the headset, he was actually, Kirby was fixing to actually call a quarterback run. I said, no, let's give the ball to Cody right here. You just knew he wasn't going to be denied. And so Kirby dialed up that inside zone, hit perfectly. And so it was his moment. It was his game. You know, you could argue that him or you know, Cody or Luther, all three had a huge impact on it. The coolest thing about all three of them is they don't really care who gets the credit. Brady will probably make them both MVP trophies and give it to him, you know, just because he just wants to win, you know.
Second row left side.
I think you'd do that, right, Brady?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
I'd do that.
Brandon Haynes, Columbia, Missourian. Eli and Johnny, can you just speak on the impact of Dalen Carnell tonight and also kind of just the depth of the defense that kind of stepped up with three starters missing?
Well, Dalen's, he's a baller, man. He comes in, works hard, leaves, comes back, works hard. I mean, there's nothing I don't think he can't do. Sacks, interceptions, forced fumbles.
I mean, if there was anybody that didn't think Dalen Carnell was going to come ball out tonight, being from Indianapolis, didn't have an Ohio State offer, was overlooked, undervalued, and exactly what we're talking about, a brotherhood that's forged in the wilderness. I mean, there was zero doubt in my mind that he was going to play his best game. Only thing I was upset with him about, he's taking forever celebrating. You know, we're trying to get the offense on the field to finish the game. But, I mean, I absolutely knew he was going to play lights out tonight and extremely proud of him and cannot wait to continue to see his growth as a player and as a leader on our team.
Next question on the left here on the aisle.
Brady, Cody, he just said that you were spending 12 hours a day looking at film, preparing for Ohio State. How much of that did you learn from him, and how much of that did you kind of use to just propel you in this offense this whole year?
Yeah, I mean, we pushed each other all year long. You know, the way we went about, you know, our business and our operation day to day, and the way we prepared together. I mean, constant back and forth pushing each other. You know, who's going to do this? Who's going to do that? You know, who's going to go here? You know, who's going to watch extra tape? Who's going to go to sleep first? I mean, we pushed each other all year long, and the bowl prep wasn't any different. The month of December, I mean, we looked at each other when this game got scheduled on that Sunday, and we said, we're going to win this thing. You know, there's no other way. We're going to send you out the right way. We're going to send these guys that came back for their last year out the right way. And, you know, we looked at each other. We said, we're going to do anything it takes to get this one done.
There's a clip in the Tom Brady Man in the Arena where Coach Vrabel talks about edgers, and we're not going to let you get the edge on me. And it was a culture that Tom Brady had, and Coach Vrabel and the rest of those guys. And I think, you know, we showed it to the team, and those guys are, you know, embodying that.
Coach, how special is it for you? Obviously, you, Kirby, the Boise State connection. You get this win. This is kind of a huge milestone for you as a coach and career in the program. How great does this feel for you?
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe on the ride home I'll think about it. I'm more proud of our team and our staff and what they've been through and fought through in order to achieve this. Yeah, it's not really about me at all. It's about our team and our players and our staff and what they've earned the right to enjoy tonight.
Okay, here on the back on the right side.
Coach, you told your team earlier this year they can't kill you because you've been at the bottom.
Yeah.
Now that you have climbed the mountain quite a bit, how does the mentality change, or does it going forward?
Yeah, it's why stop now. I mean, that's the mentality. It's why stop now. We've worked really hard to get this opportunity, and we're not going to sit here and change. So why stop now?
Brady, you know, there was a lot of 12 jerseys out there in the crowd. That's been you. Does this feel like a full circle moment for you that, you know, from starting your first game at the Armed Forces Bowl 2 years ago to this, and to know that that's been you in the crowd watching this team and to have got to this level? I mean, the feelings of that.
Yeah, you know, I mean, this was a really special night. Obviously, it was special for me, but, you know, this is about our team. You know, we keep saying that we mean it. You know, this is about Mizzou. This is about our team. This is about our fan base and the university. I mean, they deserve this. It's been a decade since we've been at a bowl game like this. And, you know, I hope they enjoy it. I know our team's going to enjoy it, but, you know, this is about the team. I've got one more year left, you know, so this isn't the end of the story for me.
So you're coming back?
No, I am coming back. Okay, I am good. Coming back. You know, so this isn't the full circle moment, you know, I've been waiting on. I still got one more year. So, you know, this is about the guys who played their last game tonight. This is about the whole Mizzou team.
You're on the right side. You have a question?
No.
Okay, we'll go right there, and then we'll go back to the left.
Coach, just wanted to follow up with another question about Blake Baker. I mean, what else can you share with us about this guy, this special thinker of football who's kind of got a fun personality too?
He just means a lot to me personally. You know, when we talk about a brotherhood that was forged in a wilderness, me and him worked together at Arkansas State. You know, we went to Boise State. Blake got hired as director of player personnel. We lived together for about 6 weeks. They only gave us 7 nights to stay in a hotel. So Blake and I were like sharing our nights, getting double beds so we could make it 14 nights. When he took the job at La Tech, I had to get up and drive his butt to the airport and drop him off at the airport and say goodbye. And I didn't know if our paths would ever cross over again. And then when the opportunity to hire him, I tried to hire him at App State, and he went to Temple instead. You know, when I got a chance to hire him, I knew it was going to be impactful because I just knew the type of energy and the type of culture he would bring to our staff. And I knew he would always have my back. And he's just a special person, and he's a great leader. He has the right type of fun with the players, but seriousness. He does an unbelievable job game planning, and he'll be the first to tell you it's the entire defensive staff. But he's got the right snap in, snap out, I'd say, right, Johnny?
Yeah.
But he's a great leader, but he's a really good husband. He's a really good dad. Most of y'all don't know that he won the Super Bowl with his son's six-year-old team this past year as the head coach. So he's got a lot of head coaching experience, and he's going to get his head coaching job here pretty soon. But we're very grateful for him to be here. He turned down a lot of defensive coordinator job offers in the last 4 weeks, and appreciative to Desiree and our administration for stepping up and compensating him and securing his future here as a defensive coordinator. But he's a special, special person and a guy I rely on. And I was glad that they poured Gatorade on him too, because he certainly is responsible for this as much as anybody else.
Closing questions now for Coach and Brady and Johnny. I think we have one on the left.
Yeah, it's for Brady. We just talked to Cody, and he mentioned that the difference in a lot of the games that were won in the fourth quarter was you. And so can you talk about just your relationship with him this season and what it was like to kind of, you know, be a captain along with him and just kind of help rally your team this entire year?
Yeah, you know, I think I spoke on it a little bit earlier, but, I mean, we just pushed the crap out of each other this year. You know, every week we were battling, and we did it together. We prepared together. Every week we just felt like the most prepared players on the field. That gave us a lot of confidence. I know it helped him out. It helped me out. But, yeah, I'm just super proud of him and grateful that he was along for the ride.
At halftime?
He was the ride.
Yeah, he was the ride. Actually, I was along for the ride.
I have time for one last question here on the front row.
Eli, Chris Venita from The Athletic.
Hey, Chris. Good to see you again.
You too. What does it mean to finish as a top 10 team with the way you guys are recruiting and all the momentum? Just kind of where do you feel the trajectory of this program is going right now?
You know, when we took this job 4 years ago, there was a belief in doing something that had never been done before, and it started with recruiting locally, developing our players, and then putting it all together. And we're still in the infancy stage of doing all that, but I think the future is extremely bright because of the plans that we have and the vision that we're carrying out. And it's not just me, it's our administration, the support they have and what they've done, building the indoor and renovation of Memorial Stadium, investing in our staff. It's what our players have done, investing in each other. It's what our recruiting is doing and getting, you know, continuing to get the right players to come play for us. So, you know, with the new 12-team playoff system, you know, this would be a game where, you know, we're obviously continuing to move on and going to have a chance to play at a higher level. So, you know, everything's coming together now, but we do understand that the wins twice is hard at the top of the mountain. And so whatever we did to achieve this year, it's going to be twice as hard. We're going to have to battle a whole new set of problems, starting with the disease of me, the disease of what about me. You know, we're going to have to go in there and rebuild the culture because I'm going to enjoy this ride home because I'm not going to get a chance to do it with Cody Schrader again. We're going to have to find new players to step up and lead. We're going to have to find new ways to connect. So it'll be challenging, but that's what the fun is. You know, the fun is rebuilding it and putting it all together and being able to say this is what we did in the past. Now this is what our vision is for the future. You know, there's a old Western movie called Lonesome Dove. It's a miniseries, and hell of a vision, you know, that we got going here. And now it's about implementing it and going and doing it.
Quick follow-up. This is the last Cotton Bowl that won't be a playoff game.
Yeah.
In the playoff era, most teams will end their season with a loss. What does it mean to just end this season with a win?
Yeah, you know, I should have started with how appreciative I am to the 88th Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic, how phenomenal this week and experience has been for our players, for our families. The way that they treated us all week, it felt so special, you know, that we had earned this opportunity. And then the way they treated us was like, it felt like the Super Bowl. And it felt like everything we did was so important to them. Anything we asked, hey, we needed a bigger ballroom for a Christmas celebration, man, they showed up and made it happen. These people are first class in everything they do. And man, I'll be honest, I hope we don't lose that in the 12-team playoff because this is there's something special about being able to have these bowl games and bowl experiences. But if this is the last one, wow, Mizzou did it right for them. I'll say that.
Thank you so much, Coach.
Thank
Brady
you.
Brady and Johnny, congratulations on quite a season. We'll be on campus soon to represent the Field Scovel Trophy and the two outstanding player trophies to Brady and Johnny. So we'll see you again here in the months and the weeks ahead.
You better get on the schedule because their schedules are going to get real busy now.
We'll try to get there quick. We'll try to get there quick, Coach. So thank you again. The transcript
M-I-Z.
For both team news conferences, congratulations. Thank you, guys. The transcript of both team news conferences will be emailed to you and can be found along with the downloadable video and audio files on the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic section of the College Football Playoff Media Portal, which is the same location you've been using all week. Here is some important news for you for everybody riding the bus. Buses depart from Lot 10 on 30-minute intervals and return to the media headquarters at the Westin. The final bus departs at 2 a.m., okay? Departs at 2 a.m. The stadium closes for preparation for tomorrow's Dallas Cowboys game. So Just make sure you have your work done by then, okay? Thank you for joining us for the 88th Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic.